Thanks for coming. I am Alessandro, that's the Italian name. I work at Microsoft, and I just noticed that the blue of Microsoft, of the logo, is exactly like the blue of the sky.
Almost.
This is so beautiful. Sorry, I have to put it as a first slide. It's one of the greatest winter I ever remember. I've been here for 12 years, and this is one of just the best. So I am a technical evangelist. If you don't know what it is, that's exactly what I'm doing today. That's my job. I'm very passionate about technology, and I help people and communities and organizations, startups, whoever, to also get passionate and excited about technology by talking and by showing what the technology can do. Nowadays, I specialize in Microsoft technology, but I really like all kind of open source and all kind of different stuff. Can find me, we can talk about all kinds of different things. The second title is serial organizer. So what I that's my thing, if you know me. I have so many meetups, I have to open another account because apparently you can only have 5 meetups in one account, so I started a long time ago. Fizo last month had a talk right here, and he was talking about meetups, he scraped some data from meetup.com. 30% of the meetups, they don't even start, they don't even organize the very first meeting. So I'm happy that with Peter we are organizing the first meeting of the cloud and container security meetup.
It still has to happen now.
Has to happen, but it's going to happen thanks to, he's pushing me, so it's good. Otherwise things won't happen, but this is where things happen. Meetups, communities, it's really, I love it. Not just because of free pizza, but also because I met most amazing people at this community, at this event, so I'm really happy to be here. And the place is beautiful, and we're going to do more stuff in TQ, which is an exciting time ahead. You can Twitter me and if you like. So I'm going to talk about an open source project today. So full open source, Microsoft is changing, right? I mean, I'm going to talk in a moment about Microsoft. So we really love open source now. So I've been doing open source all my life, I think, since I was 19, even before, with Linux. And that's why some people are confused why I joined Microsoft. It's not because I'm changing towards closed source, it's that Microsoft is changing and it's coming towards my way and our way, the way of open source. So we are here to discuss projects that are in the open on GitHub. Yeah. And you are free to fork them and contribute to them. And I'll do some demos, live demos, because recording is no. Yes. So this is a Docker GitHub. I'm not gonna mention the other container orchestration frameworks. You know what I'm talking about. There are some logos later, but you know that I also love other containers orchestration framework. But today I decided to just focus on Docker and Docker Swarm and how we deploy that in Azure, which is our cloud. So
yeah,
close it. Maybe. So Microsoft loves Linux. That's everybody knows. We joined the Linux Foundation. But also loves Docker because Docker is a partner of Microsoft. Today I'm going to talk about just one way to deploy Docker and Docker Swarm in Azure, but there are many more. So Docker Machine supports Azure, so you can use it to spin up quickly one single or multi-node Docker cluster on Azure. There's also a project called Docker for Azure, that is Docker for AWS. It used to be a closed beta and now is just a beta, but you can join, and it's about also spinning up full cluster of Docker Swarm in Azure using Docker native tools. And of course the next level is when you deploy Docker data center. That's how we love open source. That's him, and that's Mark Rusinovich, is our CTO of Azure. That's our CEO, Satya Nadella. So since the last 2 years and a half, he turned Microsoft upside down, and now we are here, part of communities, and nobody hates us anymore, I hope. You can't find me later. So this is what we do. This is our main business now. We believe that cloud is the, well, it's the future, of course. We have 38 regions, pretty big, which is more than AWS and Google combined. So these are, these are data centers. We expand, we build a data center a week, if you believe it. So these are our punchline. So we are a cloud that is trusted, responsible, inclusive. So we give choice to customers, and you can trust us because we sued the US government 4 times in the last, I think, 5 years, and we won all 4 times about privacy and protection of data of our customers, which is our main concern. So we really, and it's not easy for a US company to sue the US government. I don't know, from tomorrow, that
easy to sue,
still
hard to win.
So that's what we do. Microsoft always was about platforms, right? I mean, we always, that's our business. We give tools for other people to build stuff, right? So we have everything from IaaS to PaaS, and we are investing a lot in machine learning, artificial intelligence, bot framework, all kind of technology that you can talk till we are blue in the face, blue, Azure. So we give all these tools to you, and we like you to be creative with it, and we want to give you the most freedom. That's also why we are thinking that containers are, of course, everywhere now. Container orchestration framework are the way to go because we want to run them in production. Azure is a cloud that is meant for production. It's not a toy, it's not a, something just for a lab project, it's something that we, a lot of customers run production stuff, so we want also to include containers in the story, and that's why we are here talking about Azure Container Service. These are the security certification we have. It's just the same as every other cloud, so there's no special security there. But we have got all of them, maybe. I'm not sure. Topic for the cloud security meetup. So why containers, right? So because they are awesome, right? And people have been using them for, well, I remember first time 3 years ago, maybe, something like that. But it's great. So we recognize that our customers want containers, so we want to give them easy way in containers. So we are late to the game, and I can admit it candidly, because we are not Google. We didn't invent any of these container frameworks, but but if you are second, doesn't mean you're going to be the last, no? You can always catch up and do a good job. So I recognize there is a lot to catch up. There's competitors that have been there for a while in cloud and containers, but we are pretty going pretty fast. So I like to be part of this. So why container service? So we want to give customers the choice, so we don't want to lock in into any container framework, so that the one with a Greek name or another one, it's all fair game for us, as long as you run it in our cloud. We also don't want it to be locked in the public cloud, so we, this stuff that I'm going to show you today or now, they can be used for your private cloud if you have Azure Stack, which is a product we're going to release soon. So we don't want to lock you in just in public cloud, we just want to make sure that you know, that we transfer the knowledge about building container services to you, so you can be more effective in your work and be faster. So we want to give choice to customers. So what does it do? What it is? So Azure Container Service is it's our container service, been around for since 2014. But really, in the last 6 months, we really are pumping it up, and we released in November a thing called ACS Engine. So Azure Container Service Engine is, we released on GitHub. You realize that for us is a so it's not the usual Microsoft project. This one, it's a new way of doing things within Microsoft as well. We hire very smart people, Ross Gallagher or Brendan Barnes, and well. And I'm part of that as well, which is good. So we first release it in GitHub, and then we let people play with it. The same with it as we did with .NET Core and SQL for Linux, we release it for Linux. So we want people to play with stuff. So it's written in Go, it's the most popular language now. I don't know, it's very popular. Even me, I can understand Go in a CS engine, which is, it's also a good way to learn Go. What does it do is, it takes a JSON template, which I'm gonna show you in a moment, combines it with our knowledge, so it's all in the code, so you can just look at it. So we, it's an opinionated tool, so we think the best practices to deploy a Swarm or a Mesos cluster or a Kubernetes cluster. We want to process your JSON, embellish it with our stuff, and then we generate an ARP template. So ARP templates are Azure Resource Manager. In Azure, as I will show you soon, everything is can be described as a JSON template. So even if you click around in the portal, or use the CLI, or use the REST API, all the changes, everything that the status of the cloud of your cloud, of whatever you deployed, can be then translated into a JSON. You can download it and redeploy it. And that's what ACS Engine does, takes a JSON with your definition and then creates an ARP template that you can just push it to the cloud and work with it. So it takes away the complexity of deploying the orchestrator on top of a cloud infrastructure and distills all this knowledge. It's more than 1,000 lines of Go code and other JSON all together, smashing it into a simple JSON that you can then edit. You can edit the before the pre-process or after, and then you are free to deploy the application on top of it because you have a reproducible and standard environment. So then on top of this, you can deploy other things like Docker data center or Mesosphere or Marathon or whatever you like. So we start with the infrastructure services. So Azure is pretty interesting IaaS offering. So we not only have virtual machines, but we also have virtual machine scale set, which are sort of, I don't remember the name in AWS, but it's an auto-scaling templating VM, template VM that you can deploy one time, or 10, or 200, as you like. On top, of course, we only support Linux for now, but since Docker is supported on Windows, you can help us writing a template how to deploy whatever I'm gonna show you, so Docker Swarm, instead of a bunch of Ubuntu Linux machines on a bunch of Windows Server or a mix of the two. Then we deploy the tooling, we deploy the services around it, which means we also leverage the native load balancer of Azure. We leverage the disk, so we also have, of course, any cloud. We have a storage offering made of object store, or file store, or other kind of stores, and we can leverage that for your container cluster. And that's what we do. So you can see here that you can. It's made of layers, of course. We start from the bottom, we provision the infrastructure, and then we deploy the infrastructure, we deploy the operating system, we deploy Docker on top, and then on top you can deploy your application. So I'm gonna have this is what looks like, more or less. You can change this, of course, because this is all from a JSON file that you can edit. And it deploys one virtual network, which is comprised of two subnets. So in Azure, you have like a physical infrastructure. You have a big VNet, and you can slice it into subnets. And you can choose these ranges. You can edit. If you think you're gonna scale up very much with your agents, you can have a larger or smaller subnet. You expose the master via SSH through a load balancer so you can access them. And we support deploying 1, 3, or 5 masters for Docker Swarm. So we have a redundant infrastructure. So if you lose a master, and all these masters, when they are deployed in an odd number, like 3 or 5, they end up in availability sets, which are the equivalent of availability zones or something like that. In fact, these masters, they end up on different failure domains in the same data center, yes, but on a different part of the infrastructure. So when we update the hypervisors or when there is a outage of a specific part of the data center, you don't lose all the masters, and of course Docker Swarm will recover the state and will elect a new master if one is down. That's for the master, of course. You just need to have SSH access to it, and the rest is the agent where you deploy your application, your Docker Compose or your Docker containers, and you can level the load balancer layer of Azure. So that's how it works. You can choose to deploy a cluster up to your specification and then just deploy your app on top of it, pretty much what other container orchestration framework that do, but we make it simple for you. That's the whole idea. That's how we configure VMs. So forget Cloud Init. I also miss Cloud Init a bit in Azure, but we have another mechanism that is pretty much the same. When the machine boots, talks to a metadata server in Azure, somewhere in Azure, it's just DHCP options, and it works pretty much like Cloud Init. Downloads a script, execute the script. That's the bottom of it. We call it extension, to VM extension, and one of them is the Docker extension that configures and installs and configures Docker on the VMs. Okay. So, ways to deploy ACS is with the portal, clicking around, CLI. We have a new CLI from the old one. I don't know if you used the old one, which is Azure. Instead, now we have a new one written in Python, and it's AZ, and it's better because it's Python. Somehow. Or you can use PowerShell, or you can use the REST API of Azure. Great, so let's see if we can something deploy.
Unlock.
So, can you see, more or less? So, we have one JSON file and a make file in there. Make file is just because I forget what to do all the time. So I'm gonna go through one by one, so follow me. So I'm gonna make a resource group. So that's the portal. We all like it, it's nice, it's blue, but we like to use command lines, right? So see, there's no resource groups are collection of resources. Resource group, as the name says. So I'm gonna create a group and I'm gonna put stuff in there, so it's all there, and I can assign, I can use airbag for resource groups, so I can assign some people to some resource groups, I can connect them to different subscriptions, so the money is coming from somewhere else, from some other credit card, or if you can see that I also have different subscriptions, and the location is also part of, a group is in one location. So I'm gonna create a resource group in Western Europe, which means Amsterdam or the Netherlands, created, and then I'm gonna, so this is also quite this is the JSON I was talking about before. It's quite simple for now. You can get fancy with it, but we keep it simple for now. It's DNS prefix of the cluster, the size of the VMs, and how many VMs for the master, and the name of the pool, the DNS prefix of the agents, and how many I need, and the ports I want to open right away on the load balancer. You can always open ports later. And that's my public key and just the admin name, right? So that's so simple. That's all there is. And I can do make this engine. Maybe I should stay up. So everybody can see. So make ACS engine. done. He wrote as all outputs another JSON, of course, because that's all there is, which is more complicated and contains some information that is within a CSS engine. It contains the opinion how, if you don't tell me what to do, or if you don't have a special requirements, for example, for the subnet, I think this is a sane default, right? So, and then you can either hack into SS engine and change this default, or change the JSON that are just being generated right now. So allow values for some variables, first consecutive IPs, all kind of stuff in there. It's quite long. So this is an IRM template. It's a JSON file that contains what needs to be deployed. And there's also a Azure deploy parameters JSON, which is what contains the parameters. So what I specified as a name or how many of these nodes I need. So
what's the API model?
Sorry?
What's the last one, the API model?
Oh, yeah, it's an internal file for Azure to specify that this is that? Yeah, so contains other parameters. So Together they form a unit of deployment. So last week at another meetup, there was a guy from Kismatic which was deploying a cluster in 10 minutes. I'm gonna try to deploy it in
9 minutes.
7. So I can do make deployment here.
Don't forget to add time.
No, that's improved.
Is there?
It's just time, yes, sir.
Yeah. I always time myself in everything. So I did this before, so I know how much it's gonna take. So I'm gonna go forward a little, and I'm gonna talk about something else. I mean, unless we want to look at the screen for 7 minutes, but that's also not the best. So we also have a container registry service, which is pretty basic, right? So, but you can create it very simply as with a command line or portal. So, and we support multi-region, and it's coming, but we can already now integrate with Active Directory because we use your Azure credentials which are backed by Active Directory. So we also would like people to start using secure registries with proper user management. This is what we're gonna show you in the second demo. So now that you have this cluster, and so very nice and dandy, but what are you gonna do with it? So we also give you some help there. So as I said, we like to give a platform, we would like to give tools. So we're really good with tools, and so we have one tool which is Visual Studio, which is IDE for it's been around for since more than me, and it's a pretty sleek IDE. It's kind of like if you compare it to Jenkins, that's not fair because we can do much more than that. It's the brain of your development and integration with the cloud. So it's a single point where you can just put all these things together. By the way, we also integrate with GitLab, or we integrate with Jenkins. We kind of put everything in one center, or your control center for your cloud and code, and put it together. And I'll show you how to deploy from Visual Studio Team Service, which is our online version, straight into a Docker container cluster. So that's how I'm gonna. The second part of the demo, once that is ready, is about you start from the code, you push to GitHub, changes are picked up by VSTS. VSTS is gonna build your containers or rebuild them if there's some change. Push to the registry, create a release. So there are two phases. We work with two stages. One is to build the containers, the second is to release. So pack those containers, talk to Docker Swarm cluster, and bring your containers up and running, and I'll show you how this is working. Are there any questions in the meantime? So I think it might. So this is how it works, and I'll show you in a moment for real. Four minutes. I'm gonna go on and I'm gonna show you how some continuous integration works, because I'm not waiting for that cluster to be deployed. I have another cluster, of course, where I can show you this, right? So this is Visual Studio Online, right? So I have a bunch of builds, and what I'm gonna do is that this is the repo. It's on GitHub. I connect VSTS to GitHub. It's a simple application made of actually of exactly 4 or 5, remember? I could have split the repo into multiple repo and build them independently, but just one big repo with all the code. The code is something like this, so I'm gonna open it. So it's made of a Docker Compose, which just, this is my, Docker Compose file. So that's my container registry. I'm gonna pull the images from there. I'm gonna deploy it as a Docker Compose. I'm exposing one port, right? Which is a port that I already exposed when I created the cluster. So what I'm gonna do is just to okay. Then when I commit changes right into GitHub, the build is gonna be triggered. It is building indeed. So since I didn't change much, I'm just gonna clone the sources. And now I'm using the master also as a build agent, but you are free to use another Linux or Windows machine. If you have Windows containers, you must build them on a Windows machine. And it's just gonna, it's building, nothing really changed, so it's just very quick in building, and once everything is built, it runs a little bash script to, if you notice, in my Docker Compose file, I have a little placeholder for the build number, and I have a little script in bash that changes the build number with the actual build number, right? So this is built, so I go to release, and I can see that a release is being triggered, and not so my release does two things, and I'm gonna show you if I edit. So first of all, it copies the files over to the target machine, so copies the artifacts that I built. The artifact contains the Docker Compose file, and then runs the Docker Compose down, stop, RN, and up again. And then does a fancy thing, which is a quick web performance test of my application I just deployed. So where do I see this? I have a test here, test 10, and it's running right now, this one, but I can show you a previous run
It can, it tells you, so it's very simple. For a minute, I think it emulates 50 connection. So you can tell if there's a, if your changes are actually impacting performance or not. So it's part of the build, it's part of the, you can do also, of course, like normal smoke test or unit test on your code, but because the code is so simple, I just decided to do a performance test. So I think still running, but what happens when you actually change the code? So the release is done. Well, it's waiting for the last step, which is the test. This one. In the meantime, I can show you the actual. So this is the deployment. We have a virtual ID for the agents, which is this one. And this is my. So this is my application deployed on the on cluster. I can change the code in. I can use GitHub, see it simpler. Shop front. So I think we are not in 2016 anymore. So I think we should update it to the latest and greatest. So you got the idea. So you can continuously change your code and that's deployed to Azure Container Service right away. And if things are supposedly working, there should be a new build in progress, which is connected to a commit. And it sends me to GitHub, which shows me the commit that I just did. Let's see how this thing is doing. So this seems to be stuck, but in fact it's not. I'll show you what is happening in the portal. So we have a resource group that we just created called Large Swarm. And you can see from here that there are three masters, three virtual machines. They are the masters with their nicks and everything. And then there is a master load balancer to access the master via SSH. And there is a still busy creating the scale set. Of course, today he decided that he doesn't want to work. Anyway, so maybe later. So what is next for us? So one thing that I mentioned, unfortunately, so we still use the old swarm mode. So the you cannot do Docker service, blah blah. You cannot do Docker node ls. It's the old swarm mode, right? So with containers that run the services. But soon we're gonna adopt the new swarm kit based swarm mode, how it's called. We're gonna introduce auto scaling. So we have this infrastructure. We can monitor. We can auto scale for to because we have a scaling set, so we can scale up and down easily. And we want to do more service management, so we automatically open ports on load balancer if you need. We run now on Ubuntu, but I would like to see more choice of OS, for example, container Linux or Clear Linux or maybe CentOS, if you like. So it's only a matter of changing those JSONs and adapting the script to a new OS, and that's it. So we are working on that, and of course also taking care of the updates of the cluster and better networking. Now we do simple Docker swarm networking because we also in pre-1.12. The actual Docker version is 1.12 something, but we still don't use the new Docker swarm mode. So So what you can do is to fork ACS engine, compile it, simple as Go, so even can compile on Linux, OS X, on Windows, and start experimenting with JSON and get in touch with me and these guys that are behind the project as well. You can try container service today, or you can get free credit on Azure. How much time, I don't know, lost count of time, but a few things I want to mention. Dutch blockchain hackathon, I'm involved in this project, so if you are interested in blockchain, that's a great hackathon you can join. CodeMotion, I'm an ambassador for CodeMotion, it's a conference in Amsterdam, it's in May. You can come to me and I'll explain everything about it. DevOps Days, finally, also it's one of the... I founded the meetup some long time ago, 4 years ago, and now they are really successful. They do DevOps Days every year now. It's the 5th year this time, so it's pretty cool. And there's a call for paper open. And we can, if you want to know more about CI/CD with BSTS and Azure and containers, we organize a free DevOps workshop in Houten, which is close to Utrecht. So. And if you have ideas, you can just share it with us and make this great.
More than 10 minutes.
So, what happens is that he made a... Well, he created 30, a cluster of 30 nodes, and you can tell that I'm not lying to you, because I can show you quickly. Let me see. So, this fancy line that I can paste now. So, just SSH into the one of the master, and then ask him how many we. I think he's still adding swarm clients to the master.
Zero CPUs. Zero clients.
So the cluster attack has completed, but then swarm is still going up. So there are 30 clients competing for the masters to be there. So if you just have a little patience.
You know the curve is between us and you.
Yes, I know. So you can go for beer and come back.
Maybe
that helps. Well, I know this. I've been doing this before. So it's just the swarm coming up. So you can also do. You can see it from here. So there is. Of course, because I'm looking at the swarm cluster. So the swarm containers are up, and they're just checking in and electing the master and say, hey, there is a cluster or not? Is there a cluster?
Yeah.
Hey, yes. That's cool. See, now only 3, but more are coming in. So let's give it a little. I have 25 gigabytes, now I have 100 gigabytes available, which is pretty big. So. It's in IT you gotta have patience. It's not for the. So, any question?
You also launched talk about ACS engine. Is that available in the gallery, like in the UI?
Oh yes. I thought you didn't like that. So it's a series of blades, right, or forms, and you can say Alessandro. I'll show you how to do it. So you put your SSH key, you create a new resource group, you choose the location. Yeah, because I want to. Maybe today I feel like I want a Kubernetes cluster, I don't know. So you have a choice here of Swarm, Kubernetes, and DCOS.
And they're all out of beta?
Yes, this is a general availability. So Kubernetes is preview, which means it's there, use it, but we are still, you know, tuning and fixing a few things. Special can I talk about Kubernetes? Yes. So Kubernetes 1.5 introduced a lot of improvements in regards to Azure integration. So now we have native load balancer support. We support persistent storage, so we can create actually 1.5.2 with when you request a persistent volume to the system as an admin of Kubernetes, it creates a Samba share really on Azure and mounts that Samba share on every node in the cluster, and then you can slice a bit for your containers. So good old Samba 3.0, of course, but still works pretty well. And it's all provided by Azure, so you don't need to get crazy. It's abstracted from you. So 1.5 also introduces Windows support, so we are really working hard on having this heterogeneous cluster where you can also with Docker Swarm as well, where you have a mix of clients and tools, and you can place Windows workloads on the Windows agents and Linux on the Linux agents. So it's all in flux, of course. It's moving very fast. So I'm very happy to be part of this because I get to act all day long on this stuff. So you're welcome to help. Any more questions? Done.